Good morning to everyone. Today we are going to learn about standardization of sodium hydroxide with standard oxalic acid. What does it mean? Do you know the standardization? Standardization means something you need to find out the concentration of unknown sample. So by this title you will be understanding what is that standardization of sodium hydroxide. That means you have some sodium hydroxide solution but you do not know the concentration. Then you have to determine the concentration of sodium hydroxide solution. Then how you will do that? You will estimate or you will determine the concentration of sodium hydroxide solution by reacting with oxalic acid, and that is a standard oxalic acid. That means what is standard? Standard means you know the concentration and volume or everything regarding this oxalic solution, oxalic acid solution. Therefore, a standardization of sodium hydroxide with standard oxalic acid, it means that you have to determine the concentration of sodium hydroxide solution using a standard oxalic acid. The solution of oxalic acid, you know the concentration. Then how we can determine the concentration? We have to use a titration method or titrimetric method. Then what is titration? I think you are familiar with the titration, but just I am going to mention, to know the concentration of a solution, just this is a standardization what I am going to say. Just we will use some chemical reaction among which we know the concentration, volume or number of moles of one component and rest of the component, or if there is only two components, then if we know the concentration of one component by comparing the equivalence equation, the number of moles of equivalence equation, then we can compare the number of moles of known sample, and then we can compare to the unknown sample, and then we can find out the number of moles, and finally we can find out the concentration. So what is the strength of any solution? Today we are going to learn about the standardization of sodium hydroxide. This is an example of a strong base and weak acid. Sodium hydroxide is a very strong base and oxalic acid is an organic acid. Therefore, we are learning this title or this experiment just based on a specific category. What is the specific category? How we can determine the concentration of a strong base using a weak acid? This is our target, because we are going to learn one experiment, but we can learn several experiments. If you use this technique, then you can estimate the concentration of several strong base using several weak acids. So we are learning one, but we are going to learn several. Just if you know one, then you can use you can know several methods. Just we know several strong bases: sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, calcium hydroxide, something like this, and lot of weak acids. There are lot of weak organic acids like as acetic acid, oxalic acid, and ethanoic acid, and many more. So there are lot of weak acids. So if we can understand how we can estimate the concentration of sodium hydroxide with standard oxalic acid, then we can estimate or we can determine the concentration of any strong acid using any weak, strong base using weak acid. So let's see how we can do and what types of chemicals and instruments what we need and what are the steps we need to follow. So this is the reaction. What happens when you are going to react with sodium hydroxide and oxalic acid? This is the oxalic acid, but this is 2 moles of water. This the crystallization of water crystallization. So this is not main factor in the reaction. Just if we add this one or not, that is also okay. But mainly from oxalic acid we will get 2 hydrogen plus. So from oxalic acid we will get 2H plus, then 2H plus will react with sodium hydroxide, that means OH, 2OH. So this is the balanced equation. Here you can see what is the neutralization reaction. You are familiar with the neutralization reaction, that means the reaction between acid and base to form water. Actually in neutralization reaction what happens, 1 mole of hydrogen ion reacts with 1 mole of hydroxide ion to form water. This is very common for any acid and base. But the maybe you have learned in the intermediate level that the heat of neutralization, sometimes this is constant and sometimes little bit deviates. But this is not the topic of today's class, so we are not going to learn about that. If we have any opportunity to study the thermodynamics, then maybe we will learn there. But today we are going to learn the reaction between a strong base and a weak acid to form a salt and water. So this is a kind of neutralization reaction, but the neutralization reaction between a strong base and a weak acid to form a salt and water. So from any neutralization reaction, the reaction between OH and H plus, OH minus and H plus forms water. Therefore we will be learning any types of neutralization reaction which corresponds to the reaction of OH plus H plus and then forming H2O. Now this is the balanced equation, so we can say 2 moles of sodium hydroxide reacts with 1 mole of oxalic acid to form 1 mole of sodium oxalate plus 4 moles of water. So we know the molecular weight of each component. Sodium hydroxide you can easily find out, sodium 23, oxygen 16 and hydrogen 1. So the molecular weight of sodium hydroxide is 40. Molecular weight of carboxylic acid, this is actually the carboxylic acid, but when the carboxylic acid in crystal form, 2 molecules of water combines. So we also consider, but if it is in dehydrated state, in that case you will get only H2C2O4. That means there will be no water. If you heat this solid carboxylic acid, then oxalic acid also is a type of carboxylic acid or common name of carboxylic acid. So this is oxalic acid. So when you heat this oxalic acid, then these 2 moles of water will be removed. So that case you will have only H2C2O4. But in a standard form or at room temperature, we will get oxalic acid with 2 moles of water. So we are considering the molecular weight of carboxylic acid as H2C2O4, which corresponds to 126 molecular weight or 126 gram. This is 134, 2 sodium, 2 carbon and 4 oxygen and water 18. But for this reaction, or to know the concentration of oxalic acid, to know the concentration of sodium hydroxide, we do not need the number of moles or the molecular weight of this, but if you know, this is very good. So to determine the concentration of sodium hydroxide, we will use the known concentration of oxalic acid. So we know the concentration of oxalic acid. So what we will provide, if you have the if you have this question or this experiment in your examination, then we will provide some solution which have the concentration, you know the concentration of oxalic acid, and we will provide some solution of sodium hydroxide. You have to determine the concentration. But today we will learn from the scratch, so that how we can prepare a sodium hydroxide solution, how we can prepare a oxalic acid solution, and then we will determine the concentration of sodium hydroxide, considering that we do not know the concentration of sodium hydroxide and we know the concentration of oxalic acid. So we will learn everything today, how we can prepare sodium hydroxide solution or how we can prepare the carboxylic acid solution, and then we will determine the concentration of sodium hydroxide, considering that sodium hydroxide concentration is unknown. Okay, then what types of instruments and chemicals we need for this? Consider here, we must need sodium hydroxide and then also carboxylic acid. So this is a reaction between a strong base and a weak acid. So for any titration, we need some indicator. What is indicator? Indicator is something, some chemical or anything which changes the color, changes the color of the solution based on their pH value. That means if the value of a solution, value of a pH of a solution is acidic, then it will show some color, and if it changes into basic, then it will convert into another color, so that we can easily distinguish. So first we are considering oxalic acid. We need to have this oxalic acid. So what is oxalic acid? This is the molecular formula of oxalic acid, H2C2O4. Oxalic acid, also called as ethanediuric acid, a colorless crystalline toxic organic compound belonging to the family of carboxylic acids. Oxalic acid is widely used as an acid rinse in laundries, where it is effective in removing rust and ink stain because it converts most insoluble iron compounds into soluble complex ion. So this is very important chemical. So this can be used in laundries, so that lot of rust can rust or ink. Most of the times we put pen inside our clothes, so that the it can get dirty. So the ink or some rust from different places. Sometimes if you sit on a iron chair, in that case you can get dust from the iron chair or any other thing. So lot of dust or rust can come to the clothes, so that it is used in laundries. So normally you will have these types of white solid. This is oxalic acid, around 99.6% oxalic acid, and when you dissolve into water, you will get these types of colorless solution. This is white solution. So this is white, and then it becomes colorless in the when it is dissolved into water. In water, it gives 2 moles of hydrogen ion, because for any acid, we know when it is dissolved into water, it gives H plus ions. So for oxalic acid, it has 2 hydrogens. So when it is dissolved into water, it forms 2H plus and C2O4 2 minus this way. So it dissolves into water to give 2H plus. This is a weak acid, because the dissociation constant. Why we consider some acid as weak and some other as strong? when one acid is dissolved into water, it gives H plus, but the tendency or the number of H plus ions getting from every acid is not same. So depending on the number of H plus ions generated in the solution, we call the strength of acid. So which determines the pK value, that means pK, what is the, that means sorry, ka value, that means acid dissociation constant. So as much as H plus ions are given from an acid when it is dissolved into water, the more H plus corresponds to the more ka value, that means the dissociation constant is very large. So if an acid gives very high dissociation constant, then it is considered as a strong acid, and if an acid gives very low number of H plus ions and the dissociation constant is very less or small, then we consider this acid as weak acid. Okay, then what are other chemicals and apparatus we need? Oxalic acid already mentioned, sodium hydroxide solution, unknown concentration we will be providing. So oxalic acid, we will be providing a standard solution, that means you know the concentration of this, but you do not know the concentration of sodium hydroxide. And then phenolphthalein indicator, I will show you later what is phenolphthalein indicator and how or at what solution, what types of color we can get. Distilled water, why we need distilled water? Because distilled water has no more ions. Distilled water has no H plus or very little amount of H plus or OH minus. So if we dissolve any acid or any base, then we will get exact amount of H plus dissolved from acid or base, H plus or OH minus. Pipette of volume 25 ml. You can get 25 ml, 10 ml, 20 ml, just any one is fine. Just you need to estimate the volume using a pipette so that accurately you can determine the volume of the sample. Beakers, volume of 250 and 100 ml. So you may have 250, 100 ml or even a smaller or even larger, doesn't matter. Just you need to have some beakers so that you can keep some sample or keep some water or any other things. Balance, you need to have a very good quality balance. If you have balance which is fixed up to 4 decimal places, that is very good. 4 decimal places, that means after decimal or you can consider that if you want to measure the mass of a substance up to 1 milligram, that is also possible using the 4 decimal place balance. That means the balance which is fixed or fixed up to 4 decimal places. Spatula, what is a spatula? I will show you later. Just something what just like as a spoon. I think you are familiar if you have experience on working with the laboratory in intermediate level or in SSC level, then you should know the spatula. However, today I will show you. Flask volume 250 ml, this is the flask. Actually this is a volumetric flask or conical flask, maybe we will show you. Volumetric measuring flask, this is a volumetric flask. Volume 100 ml. Piece of paper, you are familiar. Retort stand with base, retort clamp. Burette, volume 50 ml. Wash bottle and dropper. So let's see one by one. Oxalic acid already we have seen. This is sodium hydroxide. In normal temperature, you will get these types of pellet. This is the pellet of sodium hydroxide. So we know the molecular weight of sodium hydroxide, so we will provide a solution, not this one. But if I provide this solid substance, you can also prepare the solution of sodium hydroxide. So just I will show you how we can prepare the sodium hydroxide solution. So when you dissolve the sodium hydroxide into water, you will get a colorless solution. So this is white crystalline solid and like a spillet, normally as a tablet, what we use for different types of medication. But this is very dangerous. Never try to inhale any of the sodium hydroxide. This is very strong base. So even don't try to touch with your finger, or don't try to touch with your bare hand. So just use a spatula. Then this is the phenolphthalein indicator. Phenolphthalein indicator, just a chemical, will provide it during experiment if we have any chance. Or so this is the chemical what actually inside the indicator. What happens when indicator is kept or indicator dissolves into some solutions? When the pH value, that means very acidic, if the solution of the pH is 0 to 3, that means very acidic, then the phenolphthalein indicator gives a color of orange. It will look like orange color. Then if the pH of the solution is around 4 to 7, if the solution pH has value 4 to 7, that means mild acidic, that means not very acidic, just like as lemon or something like this. So this acids are have the pH value mild acidic, so the it will show colorless. When the pH of the solution moves from 7 to 8 to little bit higher than 7, immediately the color of the solution changes pink. So we are going to study a reaction between a acid and a base. So we will have somewhere that when it is neutralized, at the neutral position the value of pH will be 7. We know the pH of water. pH of water is 7. That means this is neither acidic nor basic. So at neutral solution, the pH of the solution is 7, and if you have a little bit more basic, that means the pH value of the solution is little bit higher, then you will have a pH little bit more than 7, and the indicator will turn into pink. So we will have this types of color when we do the titration. And but we can have in other way. If you take the sodium hydroxide in the burette, that means you are adding sodium hydroxide drop by drop to the mixture of oxalic acid and phenolphthalein indicator, then what will happen? There will be certain point where the pH of the solution will be 7. That means you are increasing the pH of the solution by adding drop by drop sodium hydroxide. Then when you are reaching the neutral point, then what will happen? Just if you add one drop more or extra sodium hydroxide, that will increase the value of pH more than 7. So immediately it will turn the color of the solution into pink. So just by one drop or very little amount, that will change the color of the solution, so that immediately we can find out how much volume of sodium hydroxide we have added. so that we can get the volume, and then we can use the calculation method so that we can get the concentration of the solution. So phenolphthalein indicator changes the color when the value of pH is more than 7, that will turn into pink, and if the value of pH is less than 7, that will give you colorless. But most of the time it is very difficult to distinguish if it is colorless or not, because if there is little bit pink color, then it is very difficult to distinguish. But if you have a clear solution, pink solution, that is very easy to distinguish. So we do not want to go reverse way. We will add sodium hydroxide to the oxalic acid solution so that we can get a colorful solution. And many of you have difficulties to check the color, especially the boys. Even for me, maybe sometime I can see the pink color, but many girls who are very familiar with the dress and who different colors, but many boys do not know different colors. So just if we have any colorful solution, then it is very easy to distinguish. But if there is a very light color, we cannot differentiate. In that case, we will try to use in the way or method so that we can have the colorful solution instead of making the colorless. So if we have any way, we will try go that way to towards the colorful solution. Okay, this is the phenolphthalein indicator. Then we will have to use some pipette and pipette burette. Here you can see two different types of pipette. This is graduated, this one graduated at certain value, just 25 ml. You can use or you can add only 25 ml solution using these types of pipette. But by using this type of pipette, you can add any volume precisely around up to 0.1 ml precision. But here, this one even better, you can get 0.06 ml precision. So this one is useful. This one might be 0.5 ml, because there are several lines, so that you can have half of the plus minus. If you consider plus minus 0.5 ml, so you can get these types of accuracy. So this is 25 ml. However, you can get 24.5 or 24.3 or even 1.2 ml, like this solution you can get. But if you need 25 ml, we will try to provide you a pipette like this one. Or if you need 20 ml, we will try to provide you 20 ml or 10 ml pipette. So that is even better. This is the pipette filler. When I was a student of Dhaka University, that time we didn't have the opportunity to use this pipette filler, and that was very dangerous, because most of the time we have to use the very concentrated solution, concentrated acid, sulfuric acid or sodium hydroxide or perchloric acid. Even perchloric acid we have to take by our mouth. That was very dangerous. So never use your mouth to take the solution to put into the burette or pipette, because this is very dangerous. Any time, if by accident if you get few drops of the acid or the strong base, then you can burn yourself. So always use these types of pipette filler. I'm not sure if you have ever used these types of not. So how you can do this? Just use this part will be attached to the end of the pipette here, and just when you press this ball, then what will happen, the inside pressure inside air will be removed. So when you remove the pressure of this water, this bubble or this ball, then the volume of the pipette will be filled with the solution. So just you can control here, this is the two buttons. Just if you press these two buttons, then automatically just press this way, then the volume there is some key. So this is normally at normal condition the key is closed, but when you press here the sample will be dropped automatically. So just use the ball, just press this way and then take the sample into the pipette and press the this key and then drop the sample. That is very simple. So to fill the pipette, always use these types of pipette filler. Okay, this is burette. You are very familiar with this burette, and this burette normally the volume size of the burette is around 50 ml, but you can have different types, but normally we have the burette of 50 ml, graduated into up to 0.1 ml. The lines between this this is a larger line, this is larger line, in between you will find 9 lines, so that around 0.1 ml is the graduation. So you can get 0.1 ml or 0.05 ml like this way, because even some other burette, more precise burette, you can have even smaller lines, so you can get 0.05 ml. So you need to keep some sample. Here we will keep the sodium hydroxide sample inside the burette, because we do not know the concentration of sodium hydroxide, we know the concentration of oxalic acid, and we want to have the color of the solution to be pink. So what will happen if we put the sodium hydroxide in the burette? Then we can you have to put the sample in the burette, sodium hydroxide. Already I'm going to mention why we want to put sodium hydroxide in the burette, because we do not know how much volume of sodium hydroxide can be used or needed, and we want the solution color to be changed into colorful solution. So if you add sodium hydroxide, then you are increasing the pH value, and the when the pH value of the solution is above 7, it will give a colorful solution. So we are putting the sodium hydroxide in the burette, and we will take the oxalic acid in the conical flask for titration. This is the volumetric flask, this is the beaker. This is 250 ml, this is 100 ml, and this is a balance. Here you can see 0.0000, that means this is here 0 point decimal is here after first zero. So this balance is up to 4 decimal place accurate. So this is very good quality, and this is analytical balance, but you may have or not, because most this is little bit expensive, so many of the laboratory do not have these types of instruments. However, if you have, then this is very good. But if you have only up to 2 decimal places, that means up to 1 2, that is also okay, but the precision will be little bit less. But for these types of experiment, you do not need so precise. So when we do any research regarding very small amount of sample, in that case we need very precision. So in that case we need to have these types of balance. However, just if you have up to 2 decimal place, that is also okay. This is the spatula, what I have mentioned. This is a spatula. This can be this type of shape, or even sometime this side can be like as a spoon. just hold this side and take some sample from using this side. So you do not need to hold the sample by your hand, bare hand or finger. So you do not need to touch the sample. Just dip the spatula inside the sample and take very small amount by as you take the spoon, as you use the spoon, exactly similar thing. This is the conical flask. This volume is 250. So the you can use these types of conical flask. This is the volumetric flask, 100 ml. This is wash bottle and this is a dropper. But as I have shown you the these types of phenolphthalein indicator, if you have these types of bottle, then you do not need the dropper, because already these types of bottle has a very good dropper in the top of the bottle. Therefore you can add drop by drop. But if you do not have these types of bottle, then you need to add the dropper, you need to use a dropper. So if you need, definitely we will provide it. And then we will learn how we can do the titration of this sodium hydroxide. Oh, before that, we want to know how we can prepare a standard solution of oxalic acid, because we need to know the concentration of oxalic acid so that we can use the value of that, so to calculate the concentration of unknown sodium hydroxide. So we will prepare 1 molar oxalic acid solution first. In that case, you know the molecular weight of oxalic acid. Already I have mentioned in the previous one of the slides, the molecular weight of oxalic acid is 126 gram. So what is the molarity? Do you know? Maybe I have asked some of you during the admission test, what is the molarity? Molarity is the number of moles of any solute dissolved in 1 liter of solution. That means for sodium hydroxide, if you consider for sodium hydroxide, then the molecular weight of sodium hydroxide is 40 gram. So if you want to make a solution of 1 molar, that means concentration is the number of moles divided by volume in liter. So if you want to prepare a solution of sodium hydroxide having 1 molar molarity, in that case you have to take 1 mole of sodium hydroxide. This is 1 mole of sodium hydroxide means 40 gram of sodium hydroxide. So we want to make 0.1 molar oxalic acid solution, then how much volume you want? Just let us consider we want to prepare 100 ml of oxalic acid solution with the concentration of 0.1 molar. Then if you want to prepare a solution of oxalic acid with 1 molar concentration, in that case what you have to take 126 gram of oxalic acid to prepare 1 molar 1 liter solution. 1 liter means 1000 ml. But we want to prepare only 100 ml. So if you want to prepare 100 ml of oxalic acid of 1 molarity, then you need to reduce the amount by 10. That means in that case you need to add only 12.6 gram, because previously we mentioned that we want to make 1 liter or 1000 ml. In that case, we need to have 126 gram of oxalic acid, but now we want to prepare 100 ml, that means 10 times less than the initial one. So now we want to change the concentration. So if you want to make the concentration of that solution around 0.1 molar, so to make 100 ml 1 molar solution, you need to have 12.6 gram of sodium oxalic acid. But if you want to make the concentration 0.1 molar, again you need to reduce the amount by 10 times. So just you need to only 1.26 gram of sodium, sorry, oxalic acid in 100 ml. So take a volumetric flask, this one, this is volumetric flask of 100 ml. Put 1.26 gram of oxalic acid, just already you measured using your balance. So 1.26 gram of oxalic acid put into this one first, and then add water using your wash bottle or distilled water. You can use two different wash bottle or one wash bottle is okay, because we will use distilled water always. So to prepare the solution, you have to take 1.26 gram of oxalic acid to make 100 ml of solution, and then add distilled water up to the mark. This is the mark. So just be careful when you are adding. So just then stop the cork, just close the volumetric flask, and then invert few times, so that the concentration of the solution becomes equal everywhere. So it dissolves very good, very well. So the solution of the oxalic acid is already prepared. So 100 ml of 0.1 molar oxalic acid solution is prepared. So now you know the concentration of oxalic acid. Similarly, if you want to prepare a sample of sodium hydroxide, just most of the time sodium hydroxide solution is when you prepare the sodium hydroxide solution, with time the concentration changes. So if you prepare the freshly prepared sodium hydroxide, because when you prepare a solution of sodium hydroxide, if you keep the sample for couple of months, in that case the some of the water will be taken away just by evaporation, so the concentration will be higher. Or even sometime if there is anything reacting with this, in that case the sodium hydroxide will be settled down, so that the concentration can be changed. So even if you prepare the sodium hydroxide solution known, that case the concentration of sodium hydroxide can be changed a bit. So let us consider we want to prepare a solution of sodium hydroxide 0.1 molar. But for experiment or for your examination, you don't need to prepare this solution, or even you don't need to prepare this one. We will provide this already prepared and this also already prepared, but we know the concentration because we have prepared. That means the teacher or the lab assistant who has prepared the sample solution, they will know the concentration because they have prepared. But for the examinee, that means you will not know the concentration. So we will give you certain volume of solution, then you need to find out the concentration of that solution. So let us consider how we can prepare. Exactly same way, take a volumetric flask of 250 ml. I didn't show you here anyway, just that these types of, if I have taken any, no, anyway, in that case you will have a 250 ml volumetric flask. How much amount of sodium hydroxide we need to prepare one molar solution? We know the molecular weight is 40 gram, so 1000 ml 1 molar solution requires 40 gram. So if you want to prepare 250 ml of 1 molar, in that case you need 1 by 4 of 40, That means 1 gram. Sorry, 4 gram. No. 10 gram. If you want to prepare 250 ml, that means 1/4. 1/4 of 1000 ml. That means previously it was 40 gram. So now you will have to use only 1/4 of this. That means 10 gram. Now, if you want to change the concentration, that means you want to prepare 250 ml of 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide, in that case, you will have to take only 10th of the 10 gram, that means 1 gram of sodium hydroxide. So, take the volumetric flask of 250 ml and then measure the 1 gram of sodium hydroxide. So, already I have shown the sodium hydroxide pellet, use the spatula, use the balance and then measure the weight of the sodium hydroxide. So, just take the 1 gram of sodium hydroxide and then add water up to the mark. This is 100 ml. So, if you want to have 250 ml, then we will provide 250 ml volumetric flask and add water up to the mark. And then dissolve it, just little bit stirring or rinsing, then you can get it, the solution concentration, because the sodium hydroxide dissolves into water very well. This is a strong base, therefore you can dissolve it very well. Okay, now our solution samples are ready. Now we will learn how we can do the experiment and what we will learn from the experiment. Let's see a video, because I cannot show you the real experiment, so I am going to show you the video. Here you can see, this is the conical flask. If the video is visible.
Yes sir.
Thank you. So this is the conical flask. This is a volumetric flask of 250 ml. This is the burette already filled with sodium hydroxide, as already I have mentioned. So, this is the burette. You have to fill up to zero. The zero value is in the top. So, at the bottom is 50. So, you have to fill the burette with sodium hydroxide up to zero. Or you can fill anywhere, but you need to know the level, how much the, what is the number or what is the value of the solution you have added. So this is the system. We will see, these are three conical flasks, this one, this one, this one. So just let's see the video little bit, what she is doing. This is 250 ml volumetric flask and this is the sodium hydroxide taken into the burette. Now, I told mistake. This is oxalic acid. In this volumetric flask, I am trying to take the oxalic acid into the conical flask because we want to see the color. So, she is taking 20 ml of oxalic acid into a conical flask. She is using the pipette and pipette filler, now pouring into the conical flask. Just she is taking out the pipette filler so that easily it can drainage the volume or the solution into the pipette conical flask. Just wait here. Now she is touching the pipette pipette to the side of the conical flask and she is waiting a little bit so that last drop of the solution get out of the pipette. And one thing you can do, you can hold the top of the pipette using your finger. What will happen? With the temperature of your body, the volume of the inside of the pipette will increase and the last drop of the sample will go out of the pipette and it will come into the conical flask. So she is trying to use that technique so that last drop and it goes into the conical flask. Okay, then fill the burette and take the initial reading carefully. Already she has filled with the sodium hydroxide. Now she is taking the reading of the burette. What is the value? Let us consider 0 or something, 0.4 or whatever, anything. Now she is reading the level of the burette. And return the value. What is the initial reading? Now add the few drops of phenolphthalein indicator to the oxalic acid in the conical flask. Just she is trying to get three experiments together. So taking three conical flask and giving the phenolphthalein into the three conical flasks. So just the conical flask inside here. This is only oxalic acid and phenolphthalein. So the oxalic acid has a pH value around less than 7. Therefore, what you will get, this is a colorless solution. So colorless solution, therefore when you add sodium hydroxide using this burette drop by drop, then what will happen, the pH value of this solution will increase step by step, and when it increases more than 7, when it reaches close to 7, you will see that when we are adding the sodium hydroxide drop by drop, it appears the color, but it disappears when the solution is mixed very well. But after certain time, when we add a specific amount, what we need, then we'll get the exact color of the solution. See, now she is fixing the burette, and now add sodium hydroxide from the burette drop by drop. She is adding sodium hydroxide from the burette. Fahim, please mute yourself. Okay, and now you can see here, when one drop is adding, the color has been changed. Just see here, you can see. Okay, just when adding one drop, it changes the color of the nearby solution, but not the completely. So here you can see, just suddenly color appears and then disappears, because when it dissolves into the whole solution, then the color disappears. So but at a certain time, the color will be consistent and it will not disappear at all. So you can see the color here, you can see the color, but color disappears. Still no. Okay, now not yet. You need to add very slowly. Okay, this is the end. So here you can see the color is no more changing at all. Now she will read the burette at the final reading. That means how much sodium hydroxide has been added from the burette, and you will see these types of color change when you are adding last drop of the sodium hydroxide. And you need to rotate the conical flask continuously. Even sometimes you can use distilled water to rinse the side of the conical flask, because when you rotate the conical flask, some part of the solvent or some part of the solution can be taken away, or some part of the solution can be merged into the side of the wall of the conical flask. Therefore, if you use your wash bottle, or if you add some distilled water along the side of the conical flask, then you can rinse the solution to the mixer very well, so that there will be no wastage of your solution. So try to add some water, but you may have some question that if we add water to the solution, then if the concentration will be changed? No, the answer is no. Why? The number of amount of moles of oxalic acid is always same, because once you have taken the certain amount of oxalic acid in the conical flask, it can be 20 or it can be 10 or 25 ml, no problem. So you have taken the solution 25 ml, that lady has taken 20 ml, that is okay. So when you take 20 ml solution of oxalic acid, that means the amount or number of moles of oxalic acid in 20 ml solution is fixed. How much water you are adding or not, it doesn't matter. It will dilute, but the number of moles of oxalic acid will remain same. The concentration will vary, but we are doing the experiment regarding the number of moles, and we know the volume already. We have taken 20 ml or 25 ml of oxalic acid initially, so you know the volume and you know how much you know the number of moles of oxalic acid. So if you add more water, or even if you fill the conical flask with the water, that is also okay. But if you add too much water, that will be very difficult to rotate. So do not try to add too much water. Just add a little bit of water to rinse the side of the wall, side of the flask. Okay. So when you can see or you can observe the change in the color of the solution, that means it became colorful and the color is consistent. It do not disappear. Already I have shown somewhere the color is coming and it is disappearing with rotation. That means why we are getting the color of the solution and it disappears immediately? That can be a question from you. But this is very simple. When you add a drop of sodium hydroxide in a certain place, that means the sodium hydroxide, this sodium hydroxide is little bit more concentrated. So when you add one drop of sodium hydroxide to the conical flask, and the area, the region of the conical flask where the solution, just one drop nearby the solution, immediately it do not dissolve everywhere. So the concentration of sodium hydroxide in the solution of a certain area, just around the drop of the sodium hydroxide, is very high and it becomes basic. So the indicator inside the solution, the phenolphthalein indicator, it changes the color. But when you dissolve the solution, when you rotate the flask or stir the flask, in that case the sodium hydroxide dissolves everywhere. So the concentration of sodium hydroxide changes or decreases again. So the pH value of that solution do not go above 7. So but when we added the sodium hydroxide in a certain place, the pH value has been over the 7, therefore we could see the color. But when you dissolve, the concentration of sodium hydroxide changes and decreases, and the pH value of the total mixer is below 7, so that we see that color disappears and we know the phenolphthalein has no color when it is in acidic solution. So we can see the solution become colorless. And when we are close to the end point, what happens? Just at the end point, the pH value is 7. So when you add one or two drops more, that solution, the pH of the solution changes or increases more than 7. So immediately the indicator changes the color to the pink and we stop there and we read the reading of the burette and we can find out the volume of the sodium hydroxide, how much we have taken. So now you have to repeat the experiment at least 3 times, because you can have several types of problems or errors during the experiment. Sometime you may have, when you add this solution, you may have the concentration of the solution is very high. If you add one or two drop more, in that case the color of the solution can be very dark, that means too pink. But you need to know exactly just at the end point, you don't need to add more. So if you add more, that will give some inaccurate. However, some of you may have the difficulty to observe the color when the color is appearing. So even you may have some difficulty to read the value of the burette. So if the reading of the burette is above eye level, that means the burette reading, if you want to consider the if you want to read the level of zero in that case the lady, if she now wants to read the level zero, that may be very difficult for her, because the burette reading zero is above her eye level. So what you need to do that way, you need to take out the burette from the clamp. This is retort stand, and you need to take out the burette from the clamp and you need to hold in the level of your eye so that you can exactly see the meniscus. That means if this is what is the level, if it's lower meniscus or upper meniscus or in the exact eye level. So you need to read, some of you may have the difficulty to read the exact value. So if you take at least 3 readings, so sometime you are doing mistake on the reading. So if you have at least 3 sets of data, in that case you can average the volume of the or reading of the sodium hydroxide from your volume or repeated results, so you can get the final volume. So if we take the oxalic acid 25 ml, this is, let us consider we have taken 25 ml of oxalic acid in the conical flask. Initial bullet reading, maybe you can consider, if I show you, if you take maybe initial bullet reading 0, let us consider, we are adding the final burette reading, that can be maybe 20 ml. We can consider 20 ml, this is a burette reading I am giving in the ml. So initial burette reading 0 and final burette reading 20. The next one, if you make it like this way, just we are considering, because we are not we do not know the exact concentration of sodium hydroxide, but today we will calculate. Let us consider, when we have taken 25 ml of oxalic acid of 0.1 molar, then from the burette we have added 20 ml or 20.1, let us consider 20.1. so for the second reading, when you repeat the experiment, the second reading will be exactly same of the final reading of the burette. So that will be 20.1. or again, if you want to fill the burette with the sodium hydroxide again, you can do, but not necessary. But if you need the volume very large, maybe if we consider we need 26 ml, 26.0 or 26.2 ml, then there is no other way that you can have the volume 26 ml, because our burette can have only 50 ml. So if you have 26, if you need 26.2 ml, in that case every time you need to fill the burette up to 0 or some more than 26, so that you can get 26.2 or something. But if you need little bit less, then you can have 20.1, and let us consider then for second reading you need to, then you will have 20.1 the initial reading, and then final reading you can have 40.3, let us consider. So what is the volume of sodium hydroxide taken from here for the first experiment? For the first experiment we have taken 20.1, just final burette reading minus initial burette reading, just you get 20.1. for second experiment, how much? 40.3 minus 20.1, then you are getting 20.2. and for third burette reading, now you must need to add the solution to the burette, because we have only 9.7 ml in the burette, so we cannot add 20 ml because we know approximate we need 20 or 21 ml. So if you have, maybe we can see another experiment. If we have some difficulty, maybe we are starting from zero and by accident you have added 25 ml, that experiment, so you are getting the pink color. By accident you have forgotten to collect, you have forgotten to stop the burette dropper. This, if you have forgotten to stop the burette, so continuously the sample has been come out, or the sodium hydroxide came into the solution in the conical flask, so you have added 25 ml. So that is accidentally you can have. So in that case, maybe we can consider we have 25 ml here. Then you may guess if this experiment is by mistake. So you have found two experiments getting similar value, but here you are getting very different value. In that case, you may need to do further one experiment even. So for that you need to add another column, so you need to check, and then you need to discard this one, because this one seems to be very deviated. So you should discard this one, and you need to do another one so that you can get very similar, because consistent you need to have. So if you have if you added same amount of oxalic acid and also similar concentration, everything is same, so if you get in the first experiment 20.1, second experiment 20.2, or third experiment maybe 20, whatever, but in the third experiment you cannot get 25 ml, that is definitely you did some mistake. So you need to discard that one, and third one you need to repeat again. So we are getting, so add from 0 and then maybe 19.8, that is also okay. So that is closer. But if you maybe you already did some mistake here also, because 20.1, 20.2 and 19.1, that is little bit far away. However, this is not unaccepted, but this is within error, that can be. But now the, so what is the difference? Okay, sorry, no, not here, I should write down here 20.1 20.2 and then 19.8, and what is the volume of sodium hydroxide? Just we have to take the average of these three. So what is the average of these three? 20.1 plus 20.2 plus 19.8, so 60.1 divided by 3, so we are getting 20.03. so that will be 20.03. This is our average volume of sodium hydroxide. What we have added in the from the burette to neutralize or to standardize 25 ml of oxalic acid. So now we will find out the concentration of oxalic acid using 20.03 ml of sodium hydroxide. We do not know the concentration of sodium hydroxide. Now you will find out the result, what is the concentration of sodium hydroxide. So for calculation, number of moles of oxalic acid, you know the number of moles of oxalic acid because you have already added 25 ml of oxalic acid of 0.1 molar concentration. So what is the number of moles of oxalic acid in 25 ml? That means in the conical flask you have added 25 ml. So the number of moles of oxalic acid is, you know the formula, concentration equal number of moles divided by volume in liter. So what is the formula for number of moles? This is the volume in liter multiplied by the concentration. So here we are getting 25 ml. So if you convert into liter, so that will be 0.025 liter, and the concentration is 0.1 mole. So 0.1 molarity. So the number of moles of oxalic acid in 25 mole equal 0.025 liter multiplied by 0.1 mole equals to 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 3 moles. Now you know the equation, balanced equation. Already we have mentioned that 2 moles of sodium hydroxide reacts with 1 mole of oxalic acid. Already we have shown the equation. In the balanced equation, we have seen that 2 moles of sodium hydroxide reacts with 1 mole of oxalic acid. So how much the number of moles of sodium hydroxide in that 20.03? What was the volume? In our previous slide we have found, we have taken 20.03 milliliter of sodium hydroxide from the burette. So how much? We have found 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 3 moles of oxalic acid reacting with 20.03 milliliter of sodium hydroxide. So what is the number of moles of sodium hydroxide in 20.03 milliliter of sodium hydroxide? So the number of moles of sodium hydroxide will be double, because already we have mentioned 1 mole oxalic acid equivalent to 2 mole sodium hydroxide. So the number of moles of sodium hydroxide in x mole means we have taken 20.03 milliliter. So 2 into 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 3 moles, that will be this number of moles multiplied by 2. So we are getting 5 into 10 to the power minus 3 moles. Now concentration x milliliter, that means 20.03 milliliter of sodium hydroxide equal 5 into 10 to the power minus 3 moles multiplied by 20.3 divided by 1000, because that was in milliliter. Now we want to convert into liter, you need to divide by 1000 then liter, then you will get the concentration. So what we are getting the result, first we are getting 20.03 divided by 1000, that is 0.02003, this is molarity liter. Now 5 into 10 to the power minus 3, so 5 into 10 to the power minus 3 divided by answer, we are getting 0.249. So we are getting 0.249 mole of sodium hydroxide solution. So if we get these types of reading, then we will have this result, 0.249 mole of molarity of sodium hydroxide solution. Now, if you have any other sample like as oxalic acid, acetic acid, sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, calcium hydroxide, anything, what is representing the strong base and weak acid, by using this method and techniques, you can estimate the concentration of unknown sodium hydroxide or unknown strong base using phenolphthalein indicator by this method and by titrating method. So this is the end of my today's class. If you have any question or comment regarding this, then you are welcome to ask.